So I think yesterday Sanjeev mentions this is within AWS, this is a very exciting era because some of the products we are revamping and we are re-architecturing to fit into next 10 years. So governance registry, that's also one of the old products. And during last 1 year or so on, we are rethinking, we are thinking how industry is moving forward and how our customers and our users use this registry and try to adapt or try to bring some new ideas. So, okay, so governance registry 5.0 series is one of the milestone of that process. So let's move on. Okay, the first thing, what we have done is we did some homework. So earlier, so we had admin console. That's the only interface that someone can interact with the governance registry. But now what we are doing is we try to think, or we try to came up with some user-centric experience. So if you were in yesterday keynotes, you know that how that celebratory experience and how the people expecting to react. So same thing here. So we try to think what's the user-centric experience of governance registry. So basically we identify set of roles and what these roles to do with governance registry. So basically we identify four roles. So first one is a store user. So that is your customer. So if you develop a system or if you have a service, if you have an application, so once you represent in governance registry, so your idea is promote your service internally or externally, it could be. So that is the most important set of users you have, your store users. Then you have the publishers, those set of people who come and publish something or publish your digital asset. Then you have manager, admin. These are the traditional administrative roles. Then we have non-humans, that is agents. How another system can interact with governance registry. So now with 5.0 or 5.0 series, 5 series, what we have provided is a separate user view. So each of these groups get their own view, not an admin console anymore. For example, we have something called store, governance store. So basically all your consumers, these users, come to this governance store. Then publishers. So publishers come to there's a separate tab called publisher. Then at the moment we don't have that manager application, but this is more or less about our 5 series. So in going forward, we will introduce the manager. The manager and administrators are the people, they connect to this governance registry and perform some administrative and management tasks. Then we have our brand new REST API and SOAP API. So that is mainly to integrate with other system, basically for non-human interaction. Okay, so I will briefly introduce each of these component. So first one is, and most important one is a governance store, where you can sell, or where you can promote your digital or governing assets. So we categorize this as a one-stop store for all your governance assets. When I say governance asset, which include API management as well. So here we design, so someone can come to this store and easily find out what are the available services. So we have categorization, we have tags, and you can go through this thing. So if any of you use our previous version, governance registry 4X versions, you can see this is a drastic improvement over the administrative console we had in earlier versions. So these are some key important points. So someone can come and easily discover asset, and extensibility is a great amount of extensibility, and we support the customization and term into JavaScript. That is one good environment. So you don't need to touch the OSGI, Java code, anything like that. So it's a matter of the custom adding or modifying set of JavaScript file. And also, we support the enterprise scale of search. And another thing we have introduced is asset categorization. So basically, this is an ongoing process. Right? So earlier we didn't have any kind of a categorization. Now with 5.1.0, we introduce one level of categorization. Going forward, our path is to support is to n number of categorization, and you can come up with your own categorization. That's the vision. But at the moment, we have one level of categorization, and also you have tagging. So you, for the overlapping asset, you can define tags. Again, all these result, as you can see in here, all these pages are bookmarkable. So you can bookmark this page and send to over the mail and so on. And also, we have enabled social features, because basically I introduce governance store is mainly to promote or sell your digital asset. For example, if you are targeting general public, so you can use this social features to promote your services, APIs, so on. And these are some the improvements we have bring to the store. For example, this one is called the asset comparison tool. So basically, let's say you have your REST service version 1 and version 2. So the customer, the one of your user, can come to this here and find out what are the changes. So this is really important, because when it comes to project management, you need to know exactly what are the changes among these two new version and older version. Whether I should go to the new version or I will stay with the older version. So if I move into new version, what's the effort and so on. So this is a graphical representation. So we can provide, so what is added, what is removed and so on. And also this is the extension. So this is one of the extension we have done it for the REST services. For the REST services, now we are providing the Saga UI integration. So this is a one extension we have supported. So like that, you can add your own extension for the services. Some extension like, for example, in your store, you can introduce payment gateway. So if you want to make payment for your service consumption, you can integrate with payment gateways. Or you can introduce subscription management. You can get an idea who and how use my services. Then over to key generation. If it is APIs, you can extend to support key to interact with key servers and manage over to keys. So these are some of the important aspects of the store front. Then the next one is governance publisher. So earlier one is basically for consumers, or I can simply say it's a read-only view. Now we have our back office or write-only view. Basically, those who author or those who add services or those who add governance asset come to this place. So this is basically the basic idea is simplify the asset authoring. So you no longer need to go to the admin console. Instead of you can come here. So as you can see here, so this is we provide a guidance. For example, let's say REST service. So basically, your intention is to add REST service. Then it asks. So there are several bunch of options. So whether you want to create a REST service, whether you want to register REST service with Governance Registry manually, or whether you want to create a REST service by importing a WordL, or whether you want to create a REST service by importing Sagar file. So because these are the descriptions we support out of the box. But if you want, for example, let's say in your organization you have something like a RAML, or you have something like ELF, that's what Spring people use. So you can extend. So you can add some customization, and so you can say the REST service, whether you want to add Saga or whether you want to add a REST service with RAML, so on. So same goes with SOAP service, whether you can manually create a SOAP service or you can create a SOAP service by importing a WSDL files. So these are these two boxes is something like some first level citizens, most of the time use service and application so on. And if you add any RXT, that is the your own the way of adding assets to the governor registry, then those comes to this place. For example, here you see policies and schemas. So for your digital asset, you can write a type definition. You don't need to write anything in Java. It's a pure XML file. So you can define this XML file and admin console. That's the administrative task, separately administrative task. So administrator can add that new type into the system. Then it will display here. Right now, we don't have that facility, but it's possible. We could basically
do an export, if you will, that is the XML that describes that service.
Yes.
And insert that into our asset manager.
Exactly. That's possible. Okay, so then these are some of the new features. So the first one is, unlike in admin console, now we have graphical view for the managed life cycles. So you can see what are the life cycle and what's the current state, and you can promote or demote. So that's the one improvement. And we have a bunch of inbuilt and custom life cycle executors. Basically, life cycle executors means, so for example, let's say, so when you move in state from here to here, you can promote some tasks. So that is what we call executors. And also in the same UI, now you can subscribe or you can set up your notification. For example, if you are a manager, you can tell, you can set, I need the email message. When service moving from test to development to test, I need email message, like that notification. Now you don't need to go to the admin console or any complex configuration file. There is a small buttons, so visually you can set your notification. And also notes. For example, if you are a senior manager, if you are a senior architect, if your colleagues came up with this new service, you can add some comments. Is this a right place to add this comment, and so on. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. We have a very isolated development environment, and so we don't have an internal email server. And I was curious if you've added any type of extensibility for other types of notification, like instant messenger or something like that, other than email.
Yeah. Basically, first one is still, this is not in Carbon 5. This is Carbon 4 based product. Still, we don't have Carbon 5 based products. At the moment. So the carbon transport, so we have a bunch of transports. So it's basically transport is separated from the each and every product. So yes, even with this one, you can set up the SMS and so on. So only thing is you need to write a few, in order to bring this SMS alert into here, you need to write some JavaScript code plus some backend Java code. But that's possible. That's the accessibility we have. Sure. Yeah.
It's like behind the scenes, it's actually going, let's say I have a service for app server.
Yeah.
Let's say REST service. So it will actually go and then promote the proxy of REST service from one environment to another?
Yeah, it's like this. For example, in out of the box, right? Out of the box, if, let's say if you move development to testing, nothing really happened. It's just an abstract action. What you have is, there is a something called executors. You can register executor. So the executor can do anything. For example, executor can go to one environment and copy that whatever asset into another environment, so on.
So it'll be like, so normally in a cluster setup, so whenever you deploy something, you have some kind of deployment synchronization and other kind of issues.
Right? Yeah.
All of this will be taken care of by this, or it just something, just notify something, it doesn't do it.
So it's
basically.
Yeah, it's basically, this is a kind of a control center. So it can trigger. So whatever, you should have some kind of a deployment synchronize or whatever, Jenkins job, kind of a job. Here, what you can do is, we only initiate it. Initiate and we provide the required information. For example, we provide, this is the particular service, and this is the particular person who triggered this one, those information. Yeah.
How do we hook that up with
Yeah, basically, for example, let's say you have here, let's say you have Jenkins here. So you can write a, Jenkins executor that call to the remote API of Jenkins. So for example, if you want to move development to testing, right? So your executor, so you just click this promote button. So what then what executor does is, executor go to that, go to the configuration, go to that Jenkins server and build your artifacts and deploy into the whatever your application serves. This is possible. In fact, some of our customers already use this Jenkins-based executors.
So is it like comes out of the box or you have to write some custom?
At the moment, we don't have, but not out of the box, but we have wrote that executors for several different customers. So if you can ask for to the support, we can get it done. And we are planning to host all these executors and handlers in one place. That's in the vision, but at the moment, we don't have that in place. OK, this is another important feature when it comes to the runtime governance. Like the previous case, what we had is you change the lifecycle state. Now here, what you can do is you can associate, sorry, you try to ask. Okay. So here, what you try to do is you are trying to associate two assets. So if I take some traditional example, for example, assume this is a SOAP service, and you associate this SOAP service with a security policy, right? In governance registry, nothing really happened. So what in here, what happened is you get some association between okay, this service is associated with this policy. But what you can do is, again, there is something called handlers. So there is an abstract handler. So you can configure so that this abstract handler, you can write a new handler. So this handler can listen. This service is associated with this policy. So what it can do is the handler can connect to a remote ESB or remote gateway and push this service policy. So in case if you change or if you remove this association, again, handler can detect there is a change and it can reflect into a underlying gateways. So this is basically important for to achieve runtime policy enforcements. Then this is also a new feature. The earlier you have to go to the Carbon administration console and set your permissions in the matrix view, the complex matrix view. But this is more or less like the Google spreadsheets. So here you can select, easily you can figure out so whether you want to restrict your asset into public or whether you restrict into you or you want to restrict some groups. Through the publisher UI itself, you can achieve these functionalities. So this, and again, I discussed this asset comparison tool available with the store. It's the same thing available with the publisher as well. In addition to that, we have some new tool called dependency graph. So basically, so for example, earlier screen, I showed you this is how you can associate a policy with a service. So once you do that, so you can find these things graphically. Here you can see this is a SOAP service, and this is associated with the following visual, and it also associated with the endpoint. This is other relationships. So through this, you can graphically see this dependencies and association of a particular asset. And if you look at these two screens, you can see where we are forwarding. So what we are going to, in the future, what we are going to do is basically impact analysis. So these are the small steps to achieve to that. For right now, we have for example, let's say if you want to change this particular SOAP service, so what we need to provide you. So basically, we need to provide if you change this service, it will impact to this one, and so on. And also, these are the for example, let's say if you add a new operation or if you add a new resource to a Sager file. So these are the impacts. So at the moment, these are rendered as separate UIs. But in going forward, our plan is to provide one, the comprehensive view of the impact analysis. Yeah, earlier version versus new versions. So you can select. If you have the number of versions of the same thing, so you can select what you want to compare. And also, this is also very extensive. That means you can, there is a Java interface called comparator. So you can add new comparators. For example, let's say you add RAML. So I mentioned the RAML is not out of the box supported in here. So if you add RAML, so you can write RAML competitor. It tell the system how you compare two RAML files or your own the assets. Using the comparator, you can tell how you can compare your own asset. And the view can display the result. So this is the governance manager. The governance manager is, for example, if you... sorry. Yes, possible.
With a separate handler or customer?
Basically, executors. You can write executor. Okay, so this is something we don't have right now, but we have it in our vision. That is governance manager. We need to bring another the UI for management tasks. For example, if you go to any store, so the front end, so what you want to show in the front end is it's not automatically. You need some control. So, for example, this is in Halloween, or this is during the your what you call the let's say the Cyber Monday or Black Friday. So, what you want to show in your store? So right now we don't have that feature available out of the box, but we are building that feature. So, this is the traditional admin console. So then, so this is one of the I move into the use cases because I'm running out. Maybe I will take 2 more minutes. Okay. The first, this is something we learned from some of our customers during the last 1.5 years. So we have our own API manager solution, but people may have, or most of the cases, they already have a gateways, the hardware, gateways, or they have software gateways, they have their own key managers. So how to plug or how to build API manager solution? Maybe most of the cases what they are missing is this publisher, store, this kind of and governance aspect. So what you can do is, so this is at the moment we have a few customers already built this solution, that is this is a solid pattern. So using a manual creation or using REST API, or I will discuss it later, there is something called discovery agent. So this, using one of these approaches, you can bring, as example, you can bring a REST service definition into the governance registry. Then, through the lifecycle changes, you can automatically create an API in your gateways. So basically, the governance registry can govern your gateway. So you can create new APIs in your gateway, you can remove APIs, and also through the association. Through the association, you can associate runtime policies to these APIs, and so on. So this API can be any third-party product. Yeah, I will describe it later. It's in my doc. Okay, so this is something how you can do it. The earlier version is, so basically you have your REST definition here, and from here your executor directly go to the gateway and create the runtime API. But this is another variation. Some people prefer to do it. Your lifecycle executor trigger a Jenkins or Bamboo job, and this job will automatically deploy a new API or new service in the gateway or application server. This is another variation of same pattern. So here also, this is the one-stop governance center. So this is I described earlier, the runtime policy enforcement. So you select your service and you select your policy, then you write something called association handler. Using this association handler, you can talk to whatever the remote gateways, and you can ask, hey, apply this security policy to this service, or remove this security policy from this given service. So next one, and also one of the exciting features of this governance registry. So this is not only us. So we have merged, or we have integrated both API manager capabilities and governance capabilities. It not just because we have both products. For example, last 2 or 3 years, we haven't done that. But this is what Gartner says. So basic API management will grow into the application service governance. And this is the where maths go home. When you add 1 plus 1, it's become 2. But here, it's 1 plus 1 become 3, or so on. Because if you integrate API management capabilities and governance capabilities, you are getting more than governance or API management. So one thing is, for example, say earlier I shown you that dependency graph and impact and things. So once you have API management capability governance registry, you can use these features across these two products. For example, this could be your API and this could be your services. So you can, throughout your infrastructure, you can visualize this is how dependencies scattered. And these are the impacts, so on. So basically, we don't plan to introduce these features into API manager itself. Instead, you can combine these two features. So this is what happened. So this is the same thing, okay, same pattern, but we implement this pattern in-house. So you can see that. So there are multiple life cycles. For example, this is your governance life cycle. Basically, your service go through one life cycle. Then in a one life cycle set, what you can do is you can create your API in the API manager gateway. Same pattern we have used in our in-house in-house API management solution. So it will appear in the governance store as well. So you don't need to separate API manager publisher or API manager store. Now we have unified. So within the same governance store, you can manage your services, applications, and also your APIs. So this is another view. The earlier one is one way to achieve this. The second one is, so we create a service. So when you import a service, from outside, we can automatically create an API. Okay, the next one is the unified governance. At the moment, this is pretty much our in-house exercise. The idea is, for example, if you look at WSO DevStudio or WSO Factory, let's say you create a Jack-RS REST service through Developer Studio or Factory, and you deploy into a WSO2 application server. Or another example, you develop a proxy service in Developer Studio and deploy into WSO2 ESB, right? Then you want to create a API in the API manager. So right now you have to, for example, when you define your REST API, you provide this is the context and this is the resource and so on, right? So at the moment when you create this same API, you have to repeat or you have to provide the same metadata again and again. But what we are trying to achieve with unified governance is once you enter in here, once you enter some metadata, it will flow through all WSO2 scenarios. So this is really important. If you consider our cloud offering, so we have App Cloud, API Cloud, so on. So when you deploy an App Cloud, let's say a REST service into App Cloud, the metadata should flow into your API Cloud. So when you develop your API, we should show these are the information we can extract it from your the REST service, like that. So this is, at the moment, this is an in-house exercise. But going forward, you can replace these ESBs and application server with the third-party things. So at the moment, we have finalized the internal architecture. With the governance registry 5.2 or 5.3 onwards, we will integrate this governance, unified governance into some products. The next one, this is also important. So if you integrate with third-party systems, so you don't need to write anything. So we have developed a brand new REST API. So you just need a curl, right? You just need curl and basic code. So through the curl, you can achieve all this the third-party system integrations. I took an example as a curl. So when I say we supported curl, you know, there is no any very difficult task, right? You can write any kind of a you can use any kind of a HTTP or REST tool to integrate governance registry with your third-party systems. So still we have our proprietary SOAP API available, but it is more we advise you to use REST API as far as possible. So next one is service discovery. The service discovery is something not new. So we had in even 10 years back, we had this UDDI, WS discovery, the same things. But with the merge of the microservices, this is also becoming an interesting trend. So we support both pull mode and push modes for the service discovery. That means, so you can basically, your governance registry can pull data from a third-party gateway or third-party server. So what you can do is, for example, you can write something. For example, let's say this is a WSO2 application server. So you can write an application server discovery agent. So this discovery agent can connect to a application server to remote API and pull metadata. That is a pull mode. Or you can push mode, for example, especially with the microservices. For example, let's say you have a Spring Boot microservice. So when an application is startup, you can publish, hey, this is my metadata to the registry. And when it gets shut down, it can say, OK, I am going offline. So these informations are available in the registry. This is the push and pull mode. So this is how usually we implemented this for the microservices. So when the microservice startup, we will send these events, address service at the endpoint. When the shutdown, we say delete endpoint. So when you're getting more and more nodes, so it added more endpoints. And when the service is getting deleted, or the registry can reflect those changes. So you can use it any of the microservices, like a WS2 microservice, Dwarf Resorts, Spring Boot, and so on. And we have supported microservice pattern as well. So basically, we support both client-side discovery and server-side discovery, both offerings. The client-side discovery means your service client is very smart. So it's basically contact the service registry, in this case, governance registry, and find out available endpoints and use one of these endpoints to contact. And when it comes to server-side discovery, your client is lightweight or very dumb. It just send a request to some kind of a gateway. Then gateway contact the service registry and find out what are the available endpoints and perform the task. So this is really important with the microservices, because of the microservices, the services are disposable. At any given time, your service can disappear, right? There is no guarantee. And also, the microservice, one of the important things is the services should be resilient, right? So if you were in the yesterday talk about Kubernetes, that is one part of the solution, and this is the other part. In Kubernetes, it manage it can dynamically bring a new service instances. But this address the other part of the problem. So once you have a new service, how do you get the it presents, and how do we contact? So what you can do is, Docker or when Kubernetes bring a new service, it can itself register with the governance registry, so the client can query the registry to explore the new endpoint. So again, there is another two patterns, self-registration and third-party registration, so both is possible through our REST API. So this is how we support it for the microservice patterns. So since I'm running out, so these are some deployment patterns. So you can go through, once I upload this slide deck, this basically you can have store embedded and store and publisher embedded, or you can distribute store and publisher. Or the another new thing is Solr. If you need very high scale of searching facilities, you can externalize our Solr. Solr is our indexing engine, so you can externalize this. So that external, you have cluster of registries talk to a distributed or the centralized and externalized Solr server. And this is how you can distribute it, API manager. So when you have API manager, you may have store and publisher within one JVM, and you can have key manager and gateway separately. Here you can see there is no separate API managers, publisher and store. Those are unified with the governor registry store and publisher. So this is partially distributed, or you can achieve the fully distributed based on your capacity and your requirement. Okay, so finally I've reached the end of this story. So this is the product roadmap. So at the moment, the very high priorities go to unified governance. That is how we integrate our WSO product with each other. Then we need to planning to develop our manager application. And this is the for the next major release. This is the most prioritized item, the statistic and dashboards. So how do we provide, for example, if you need to, within the governor registry itself, we need to provide you how many consumers use your service and how they use, what are the policy violation, those information. So we are rethinking to merge dashboards and statistic into governor registry itself. Then multi-level categorization, and also we are planning to standardize and provide out-of-the-box set of executors like a Jenkins executor, then also the out-of-the-box discovery agents, and finally the registry part. The registry part we will plan to rewrite based on C5, but it's transparent to most of the governance user customers. It's an internal change. So this is pretty much about our changes. So I will avail the rest of the day. So if you have any question, feel free to talk to me. Okay, thanks for the time.